Hi folks, good evening. Thank you for joining us. Welcome everyone. Thank you for joining us tonight. We'll just wait for a few more people to come on in. Hi everyone, nice to see you here. Thanks for joining. Hi Leonard. Welcome everybody. Okay, well, I think we will make a start. Well, hello everyone and a very warm welcome to the online Naturetrek Roadshow. I'm Sarah Frost, Naturetrek's marketing manager, and I'll be your host for this evening, speaking to you from Hampshire, where it is a cold and wet evening. Now, on a cold, wet night like tonight, you might be wishing that you were somewhere warm and sunny. Unfortunately, we've got just the evening for you because tomorrow is officially the first day of summer in Australia. Now, Australia offers a wonderful variety of scenery and habitats, varying from the rich rainforests in tropical Queensland, temperate forests in the southwest, arid deserts of the interior, to the warm tropical waters of the Great Barrier Reef. And tonight we'll be talking about Queensland, Southern and Western Australia. And also further off the beaten track, we'll be going to Papua New Guinea, which supports the richest avifauna of any island in the world. And joining me to take us on our journey there are my colleagues, Georgie Head and Alison Steele and Matt Eade. Now, Matt isn't here right now, but he'll be joining us a little later. He's currently leading a Naturetrek tour in Somerset. So he'll be joining us once he's had his dinner with our guests live from his hotel. And we're also joined once again by some of our experts from outside the Naturetrek office. And it's a pleasure to welcome Paul Harms with us this evening. And we're especially fortunate to have Roger Smith speaking to us live from near Melbourne, Australia, where it has just gone 6:30 in the morning. So we're incredibly appreciative that Roger's made a very special effort to get up early and talk to us. So a very warm welcome to you, Roger.
Thank you.
Before we head to Australia, our tailormade manager, Georgie, is going to provide you with a quick introduction to tailormade wildlife holidays with Naturetrek. So as always, folks, please do put your questions to us using the Q&A section at the bottom of your screen. We'll type replies to you as we can throughout the evening, but we'll take the majority of the questions after the last presentation has finished at the end of the evening. So I hope you're all sitting comfortably with a glass of wine and some nibbles. And without any further ado, I'm going to hand you over to Georgie.
Thank you very much, Sarah. Good evening, everyone. I'm just going to share my screen with you now. There we go. Hopefully you can see that. So as Sarah mentioned, my name is Georgie. I am Naturetrek's tailor-made manager. I also actually look after our portfolio of holidays to Australia, which you'll hear all about this evening. But before we get started with that, I just wanted to give you a bit more information about another area of Naturetrek that I look after, which is our tailor-made department. So most of you will probably be familiar with our group holidays. That's our bread and butter, and it's what we've been doing for the last 30 to 35 years. We've always done tailor-made holidays on kind of an ad hoc basis, but more recently, over the last few years, we now do them as a more sort of concentrated effort. And we've got actually a whole team of people in our office now who look after our tailor-made tours. They've become incredibly popular, but we do find that some people don't really understand what they're all about, and there are some common misconceptions when it comes to tailor-made holidays. So I just want to give you a brief introduction to exactly what it is we do with tailor-made and what possibilities there are. So one of the first questions that probably springs to mind is, where can you travel to on a tailor-made holiday? Now, the possibilities really are pretty endless. The thing that really affects where we can offer tailor-made holidays is whether we have local guides available in the areas. Now, the benefit of traveling with a company like Naturetrek is that we've been operating for over 30 years. And so we've built some incredible relationships with some of the best naturalist guides in the world who will be looking after your holidays. So we can offer holidays to Australia, we can do Antarctica, and more recently we've been coming further, sort of closer to home, and offering lots of holidays in Europe and the UK as well. Some people like to stay close to our group itineraries and follow those closely, while others like to visit other completely different destinations. So we can even offer holidays to places that we don't visit on group holidays, such as Zimbabwe, Vietnam, and even Rwanda. And we can also visit those parks sort of off the beaten track that we don't necessarily get to visit on our group tours, just because we don't normally have time. Who can travel on a tailor-made holiday? So you'll probably find that we don't actually offer that many holidays for group holidays for children, mainly just because we find that with wildlife travel, it just by its very nature, it does require quite a bit of patience, which some children can struggle with. And so on a tailor-made holiday, it's completely flexible. We can offer sort of shorter days and different activities for children, so we can make it really tailored to them, so they really are brilliant holidays for children. Otherwise, people might like to come on a tailor-made holiday if, for example, they find our group holidays too fast-paced, if they're looking for something a bit slower, and mainly most people we organise tailor-made holidays for are either couples or groups of friends, so tailor-made holidays really can be for anybody. There's also a very common misconception that tailor-made holidays can be very expensive. Now, they certainly can be. We can organise very highly luxurious holidays if that's what you're looking for, but they don't necessarily need to be. There's a few different things to think about when you're trying to think of a budget for holidays, and one of them is the time of year that you'd like to travel. A lot of people don't realise that if you travel in the green season or the off season in different areas, that can make a really big difference to the cost. Otherwise, the main thing that's going to affect the cost of your holiday is the guiding style. Now, if possible, we'd always really recommend that you travel with a private naturalist guide throughout your holiday. This has got numerous benefits. The guides that we work with are really excellent, and as I mentioned earlier, we've worked with them for many years and they are some of the best. They will also get to know you very personally. They will get to know any key species that you are really interested and excited to see, and they'll also know what you've seen on previous days. They'll know whether you're interested in photography. We can match you up with photography experts or experts who really share your interests to really make the most out of your holiday. But if you're on more of a budget, we can also organise lodge-based holidays where you would take shared excursions with lodge guides. We choose all of our lodges based primarily around their proximity to wildlife and the wildlife experience. And so you, even with lodge guides, you know you're going to be in excellent hands, and so that really is a great option as well. If you're on an even tighter budget again, then we can also organise self-drive holidays for you. Those aren't possible in all destinations for safety concerns, but somewhere like Australia or New Zealand are fantastic places for self-drive holidays. We could organise for guided days interspersed between. And we can also organise self-drive holidays in places in Africa, such as South Africa, Namibia, or even in Costa Rica. So really, the world is complete your oyster. Speak to one of our experts. We can discuss your budget, your interests, and we can organise anything for you. People also wonder when they can travel. A very important question, particularly at the moment. Some people like to spend sort of 3 years planning their holidays and love to have that anticipation for those once-in-a-lifetime tours. But other people increasingly are looking for last-minute holidays, particularly at the moment. Our experts are there to help any step of the way. So if you're looking for something for this Christmas or possibly even earlier in the new year, then we can certainly help you with that and help organise anything last-minute that you might like. So I hope that's given you a very brief, very, very brief introduction about what is possible with tailor-made. So if you've got any ideas or would like to discuss anything further, please do give our experts a call. You can also order a copy of our dedicated tailor-made brochure, which you can order through our website or by contacting our team over the phone. Or you might even like to take a look at our dedicated section of the website, or the tailor-made section, where you can find sample itineraries, you can find lots more information about the parks and areas that we visit, and lots more information about the lodges that we go to. But whenever you're ready, please do feel free to contact us, as we love nothing more than discussing your holidays. So that was a very whistle-stop tour, but now I'll get back onto the main part of the evening, where Roger will bring you into the wildlife of Southern Australia. I'll just stop sharing my screen and then pass over to Roger now. Thanks, everyone.
Roger, you're on mute. If you could just unmute yourself.
Thank you. Well done. Thank you, Georgie. I'm all set to go and the sun's shining behind me and I'm having a little bit of trouble seeing my own screen at the moment. I wasn't expecting that, but I can see it, which is wonderful. Just let me have a quick look about where I am.
Well, it's a very sunny morning there for you, Roger.
It certainly is. And I wasn't expecting this, but here we go. There we go. Can you see that, guys?
Yeah, we can.
That's great. Okay. I'm just going to go to full screen and we're off and going. Okay. Thank you, everybody, for coming and joining us in Australia. And I'm hoping that during this presentation, the sun will go up a little bit behind the eaves on the house. I'm around about 90 kilometres west of Melbourne in southern Australia at the moment. And the animal I'm showing you is one that I've loved all my life. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about the wildlife of southern Australia as we go forward. Australia's flora and fauna is unique. The big banding marsupial in front of you is my favourite and has been ever since I was a child. You can tell this is a female due to its small arms and its small front feet. I'm just letting you know that because I thought you might be interested. She's also a grey and the male is generally red, but as with all things in nature, they can sometimes swap around, but the girls will always have little hands like that. Now, we're talking about the wildlife of southern Australia, and you're with Echidna Walkabout. I'm one of the owners of Echidna Walkabout, and we work closely with Naturetrek, and are very, very happy to do so. And we work with a wonderful guy here in Australia who I know is listening at the moment. I want to mention him. His name is Graham King, and he works with Naturetrek and brought us together. So thank you for doing that, Graham, and thank you for Naturetrek for coming to us to help lead your wonderful tours through Australia. I've just brought this thing up at the bottom here, which is help nature while you enjoy it, which is really a philosophy of ours. And I'm very briefly going to take you through that. Help nature as you enjoy it has got a lot to do with experience, what a belief that we have that you experience. It's the new type of travel, something we've been doing for a long time and more people are doing, but the whole idea and the philosophy behind it is you experience something, then you learn about it, and then hopefully you act on it. And a number of years ago, we created an organisation called Conservation Travel Australia. I'm not going to go into all the details of this, but I will put that screen up again later on in the presentation. But it's a relationship between Echidna Walkabout, that's my business, our business, the Koala Clancy Foundation, which is our not-for-profit, and in this case, a relationship with Naturetrek. And we're very proud to be able to pass this on to you on our tours. But the whole idea is that we help people act to make the world a better place. Now, I could talk about this for hours. It's something we believe very strongly in. It's got to do with climate change. It's got to do with the connection between wildlife and wild places. And we believe it's something that helps people choose positive conservation action and responsible, sustainable tourism as the primary reason for travel. We offer you direct pathways to give back to the environment. So that is that, putting that to one side, but knowing that throughout my presentation today, that's uppermost in what we're interested in. Oops, that's Australia. It's upside down. I better turn it up the right way. So there we are, we're in Australia. Welcome to Southern Australia. We're going to go inside the White Triangle, which is in southeastern Australia, which is where most of this trip happens. I was just near the pointers open. what I wanted to do is I just wanted to give you a rough idea of where you are in southeastern Australia. Melbourne is here. Sydney is up here, and you're going to arrive in Sydney. You're going to spend the first couple of days or day and a half in Sydney. And one of the things you'll do is go to the Blue Mountains. We won't be with you at that point, but Graham King in Sydney will be, and he'll make sure that you're looked after well. Then you'd fly down to Melbourne, and where you'll meet us. The next few days will be spent in East Gippsland over here, which is a wilderness area of forest, coast and rainforest. Then you'll come back to Melbourne, and then in this area around here, we're going to be spending some time at the Western Treatment Plant, which is a major birding spot in southeastern Australia. Then for the next few days, we'll be out, I can't see where my pointer is, we'll be down in the Great Ocean Road area before coming back to Melbourne, and you'll have to forgive me looking around because the sun's on my screen, and then going from Melbourne up to Mungo, which is up the top here. And what I'm going to do now, there's one thing I want to tell you, that the travel direction on this trip may vary depending on a whole range of different things, but in general, that's the way you'll go. So let's go first of all to Eade Gippsland, which is the start of our trip. And this here is one of my favourite birds. It's the white-bellied sea eagle, which is, to me, is the great image of East Gippsland. It's wild and free and needing a high level of biodiversity to survive as an ocean and river predator. It's the second largest of our eagles. The biggest is the wedge-tailed eagle, which is one of the biggest eagles in the world. This is what East Gippsland looks like. It's where Captain Cook first sighted Australia in 1770. In fact, this picture was taken just near there, just near that location. And the region has changed very little since then. It's rich in forest. The picture is of the Croajingalong National Park, which has been designated as United Nations World Biosphere Reserve. I've travelled and guided widely throughout Australia, and this region is one of the richest in wildlife in the country, and believe me, it is. The wildlife bounty here is truly remarkable. There's over 300 bird species and dozens of mammals, both on land and in the ocean. Our wildlife lists from this area are regularly the highest of anywhere in Australia. And I'm just going to run you through a couple of them. This is an echidna, from which we get our name. I hope you can see this. This is a fellow who managed to get very close to an echidna and got a wonderful shot of it. Not that particular photograph, but he got one very similar to it. The eastern water dragon, which is a dragon lizard that grows up to about a metre long. This one here is about half that size. The wonderful eastern grey kangaroo, one of my favourite animals. And the koala, of course. This is the rainbow lorikeet, which is one of Australia's most magnificent lorikeets. I just want to talk briefly about some of the conservation efforts on this trip, which harks back to helping nature while we enjoy it. You get involved. I'm going to run through these very briefly, by the way, because I could go on and on. We do many, many actions on our tours, but I'm just going to give you an indication. We get involved in a major koala conservation program on the island, on one of the islands we go to in East Gippsland. And we also get involved in something a lot of people don't think about. This is a ghost net which is washed up off the Southern Ocean in eastern Victoria, in eastern and southeastern Australia. We often see these on the beaches. So what we decided to do was to ask our guests if they wanted to get involved in collecting these ghost nets and bagging them up and taking them to the local tip, which is what we do. And we've actually removed huge areas of ghost nets from some of the beaches in eastern Victoria and in East Gippsland. And we follow that up, after you've done all that hard work, we follow that up with a beautiful dinner overlooking the Southern Ocean. There's a beautiful spot looking out over the Southern Ocean. We do a lot of outdoor eating on our tours and we enjoy it. If we can't, we go back to our lodge where we have dinner at the lodge. But this is a wonderful experience. This is one of the places we stay at in eastern Victoria, in East Gippsland. This is the Snowy River Homestead. which is a magnificent place. And this is an indication of the sort of rooming that you'll be staying in. It's all 4-star accommodation, and you'll stay at this place throughout your trip in East Gippsland for 3 nights. Now we'll swing back to Melbourne, and we'll spend a night in Melbourne, and then we'll come to this remarkable place. This is the Western Treatment Plant, which is a fantastic place to see birds. It's one of the most highly renowned bird watching places in Australia, and ranks as one of the best in the world. This photo gives you an inkling of how profoundly abundant bird life is in this region. There's migratory waders, there's ducks, then there's black swans in the background. It's only about 45 minutes from Melbourne. You'll see brolgas there, which is a native Australian crane. And looking back behind you from the first photograph back towards the Yuyangs, which we'll go to the next day, these are whiskered terns. It's only about 45 minutes from Melbourne, and you have to go in there with a special permit. We have permits to take you into the Western Treatment Plant. This is the Yuyangs, which we go to the next day, and this is Smokey the koala. I just lost track of where I am now. This is Smokey, and she is a beautiful koala that we've known for a long, long time. She is the grandmother of another koala called Pat, who is the mother of koala Clancy, who I'm going to show you now. And that's Koala Clancy. And that's the name of the organisation, our not-for-profit, called the Koala Clancy Foundation, which this year has planted 45,000 trees to help koalas in southern Australia. We're very, very proud of this, particularly doing this in a pandemic. It was extremely difficult, but Koala Clancy is an amazing guy. We still see him at times. Unfortunately, his grandmother, that girl there, is no longer with us. While we're in the Yuyangs, we get you involved in pulling bone seed, which is what this gentleman's doing. He's ripping a bone seed out of the ground. Now, you might wonder why we do that. We do it because the bone seed is an invasive weed which stops koalas moving around, particularly in their breeding season. They can't find each other, and if they can't find each other, they can't make babies. I know it's pretty obvious, but it's incredible through the work that we've done here, our koala, the abilities for the koalas to breed has increased about 200%. So where we once saw maybe one a year or two young ones a year, we now see up to 5, 6 or 7 more a year. And that sign that you can see there is a sign that the National Park Service put up for us about our bone seed control program. Moving on, we go down to the coast on the Great Ocean Road. Now, some of you would have heard of the Great Ocean Road. It's a spectacular region. I highly recommend it for you. And I don't know how I'm going for time. I'm getting there. I'm going to move on a bit. This is again on the Great Ocean Road, where we'll see bottlenose dolphins. This is an indication of the type of accommodation that we have on the Great Ocean Road. Next, we're going to go to Mungo, which is a very different area altogether. We're going to go to the arid outback. And this gives you an idea of where you'll fly to at the end of your Great Ocean Road trip. And this is what you'll see on your second day in the Mungo region. This is an extremely important place. It's a World Heritage Area, and it's where the oldest human cremation sites have been found, 50,000 years old, and some of the megafauna of Australia have been found here as well. You'll learn all about this on the trip. And you'll also see some of these spectacular cockatoos and lots of other wildlife at Mungo while you're there. I love Mungo. I grew up not far away from here. It's one of my favourite places. Bearded dragon, a close-up. Me showing this woman a bearded dragon. It's one of the few animals you can get very, very close to in Australia, and they're tough. One of the major reptiles that we'll see at Mungo. And just to finish up, this is a picture that I love, but I just wanted to show you a little bit more of Mungo. This is some of the lunettes at Mungo, which have eroded away to expose some of the ancient burial sites and some of the ancient animals of the megafauna of Australia. This is my co-director, Janine, in front of a group of emus. This is the lodge that you'll stay at, Mungo Lodge. We'll stay there for two nights. It's a wonderful place. Give you an idea of the rooming at Mungo and the dining room at Mungo. And that's where I'm going to end. I'm going to hand over to Alison. She's going to be talking about Papua New Guinea. But thank you for having us. And please come to Australia. We'd love to show you around this fantastic southern part of our country. And I can assure you, you'll have a wonderful time here with Naturetrek and us. Thank you so much. I'll hand back to you guys. I better stop sharing.
Thank you, Roger. That was fantastic. Alison, over to you.
Great. Thank you. Good evening, everybody. Let me just quickly get my presentation up and I will share that with you. Okay, so my name is Alison. I'm one of the operations managers at Naturetrek. I've been there for around about 6 years now, and one of the areas that I help look after is Papua New Guinea. I'm sure many of you know where it's located, to the north of Australia and to the east of Indonesia. And it makes up one half of the world's second largest island, New Guinea, plus around about 600 islands as well. It's got a population of 9.1 million, give or take, and a size of around about 179,000 square miles. The highest point is based in the highlands at Mount Wilhelm. Throughout the area, English is one of the main languages spoken in sort of commercial and government settings. However, Tok-Pisin is one of the most widely spoken of the languages, although there are around about 800 different languages spoken throughout the country overall. About 85% of the people live in rural locations. However, the largest and capital city is Port Moresby. It's got very, very rich biodiversity, and bird life is some of the particularly noticeable ones that you'll see if you come to visit, varying from the cryptic and camouflaged right through to the colourful and flamboyant. It's had over 900 different species of bird recorded in the country, including the national bird, which is the Rajana Bird of Paradise that appears on the flag. Due to its position, you get a mix between Australasian and Asian species, as well as some of the endemics that are only found within that area. It's home to seven endemic bird families, but also around about 10% of the world's vascular plants grow there. Around about 1,000 species of butterfly can be found, as well as hundreds of different frogs, reptiles, mammals and fish. And many people think that there are still quite a few species that are undescribed by science. So this evening, I'm mainly going to be talking to you about one of our newer Papua New Guinea tours, our Highlands and Islands tour, which visits three main locations. Port Moresby, the capital city, Rondon Ridge Lodge, which is set up in the Highlands, and then out to New Britain Island to stay in Kimby Bay. So when you arrive, you fly into Port Moresby, and then after a short while to have a freshen up and a chance to get your bearings, you'll have a gentle afternoon start out to the grounds of the PAU, which is the Pacific Adventist University grounds, for a chance to get an introduction into particularly the bird species of the Australo-Papuan variety. The area here is a mixture of dry woodland interspersed with small water bodies, open spaces and riparian vegetation, which is habitat roughly typical of what you find around about the Port Moresby area. And there you'll be looking for species such as the cryptic Papuan frogmouth, the stripy forest bittern, or perhaps the colourful blue-winged kookaburra, along with lots of other species such as butcher birds, bower birds, friar birds, fairy wings and honey eaters. Around about the pond areas, you may come across a comb-crested jacana, perhaps the pied heron, or maybe the plumed whistling duck. After a good night's sleep and a chance to have caught up on your jet lag, the next day you'll head out of the city to the east, to Vararata National Park. This is Papua New Guinea's first national park, and it opened in 1973. It's made up of around about 1,000 hectares, between a height of about 600 to 800 metres. It's forested with open areas, mainly a mix of eucalypt savanna and secondary forest, with the main trees being native casuarina trees. Typical bird species found in this area include the Brahmini kite, the frilled monarch, the hooted pitui, which is one of the few poisonous birds in the world. You may also find some roosting barred islet nightjar with their large eyes, or perhaps some impressive Blythe's hornbill, along with fruit doves, cuckoo shrikes, kingfisher, flycatchers, and whistlers. But one of the main reasons for heading out to this national park is to see the Rajana Bird of Paradise, Papua New Guinea's national bird. During the time of this tour, it's lekking season, so a lot of the males gather in display areas, fanning out their impressive tail feathers, hanging upside down with the long trailing streamers waving in the air, and calling to attract the females. This is one of five bird of paradise species that can be found within this national park. From here, it's then time to head on up into the highlands, taking a flight up to Mount Hagen and then up to stay at the lovely Rondon Ridge Lodge. It's set on one of the hillsides of Mount Kuta, just around below the forested area, above the agriculture and at the edge of the native forest. And it overlooks the Waggy Valley, which is considered to be one of the first places in the world that developed agriculture. In the grounds of the lodge and along the lower forest trails around about it, you might come across species such as the blue-capped ifrit, which is one of the Papua New Guinean endemics, along with honey eaters such as the mountain red-headed Mysomela, or perhaps Belford's Melodectes. Crested satin birds are also found in that area as well. They were once thought to be part of the bird of paradise family, but have since been split from that. And you also might find some colourful lorikeets or perhaps some fantails as well. One day that there'll be opportunity to head up into trails higher behind the lodge, look at the bird of paradise species, and perhaps one of the more subdued colour ones, such as this short-haired paradigalla. But there are also more flamboyant species, such as this King of Saxony bird of paradise, which has got very long and impressive head streamers which it waves around. And there's also the colourful bluebird of paradise, which has got a very, very musical call. But it's not just birds that are looked at during this tour. We'll also be looking to see what else is around as well. And species that you might find in this area include the large Atlas moth, which is one of the biggest wing area moths in the world. And the silky owl butterfly with its deceptive eye spots. Rondon Ridge also has its own orchid trail, which is a fantastic place if you're interested in some of the plant species. And mammals are a little bit harder to see around the area, perhaps because they've been hunted for quite a long time, so they tend to be quite shy, but ground cuscus are a possibility, and this is a type of marsupial. There'll also be time to find out about some of the local tribes in the country. There are over 600 different tribes to be found in Papua New Guinea. If you visit Polga village, you'll visit the Asaro mudmen, who like to reenact their ancestral victory over an enemy tribe, where the evil spirits were imitated to try and scare away the opposition. This is using pale clay to make their bodies appear much whiter, using intricate masks and accessories such as weapons and bamboo claws to make themselves more intimidating. The Melpa people are one of the local tribes which are quite prevalent in the area. They value pigs as a sign of status, and they're thought to be one of the cultures that are predisposed to capitalist ideas, having quite an entrepreneurial spirit, and show forms of materialism. And then there's the Chimbu tribe. They use a mixture of dark and light coloured mud to paint skeletons on the bodies, particularly of boys and men, and then they dance to intimidate their enemies. One morning there'd be a chance to visit another lodge in the area called Kumo Lodge, which has got a well-established bird feeding station. A number of bird of paradise species can be seen coming down to the feeding areas, and these include the brown sycobill and the ribbon-tailed astrapia. Now, there might also be a number of other species around, such as the barred Bram's tiger parrot, or perhaps the crested berry pecker, which is another endemic species. Thrushes and robins are also likely to be seen, and here you may come across another couple of mammal species, such as Calabi's pandamelon, or perhaps the speckled dasia. Eventually it'll be time to leave the Highlands, taking a flight back down to Port Moresby and then across to New Britain Island, flying on one of the sort of smaller aircraft that tend to be typical of the region, but it often means that you can get good views of the countryside below. In New Britain Island, we stay at the lovely Willindi Plantation Resort, usually in one of their plantation rooms. However, it is also possible to upgrade to some of their ocean view bungalows. However, all the rooms are very welcoming and comfortable. From when you arrive, you'll notice around the grounds there are lots and lots of different birds calling, and there's plenty to be seen without leaving the resort. Some of the more obvious species that you might come across include the large white-bellied sea eagle, Roger was talking about in Australia, so one of those crossover species that occurs in both countries. Also perhaps large groups of noisy, chattering, metallic starling, or perhaps a glimpse of a colourful eclectus parrot. One of the reasons for heading out to this part of the country is to allow us to get out onto the oceans, and taking a pelagic trip, it's possible to find quite a lot of sort of ocean-going birds, including red or white-tailed tropic birds, shearwaters such as the wedge-tailed shearwater, or perhaps the rarer hindroths. Brown or red-footed booby are both possibilities, as are lesser or perhaps great frigate birds. There's also a possibility of Beck's petrel as well. But it's not just the birds you'd be looking for when you're out in a boat, and there's lots of whales and dolphins that can be seen in this area as well, including these playful spinner dolphins. On land, there'll be a chance to explore some of the forest areas as well, and species that you might come across there include the black-capped lorikeet, the tiny buff-faced pygmy parrot, possibilities of nesting or roosting nankeen night heron. You might perhaps see a hunting variable goshawk sweeping through the branches, or perhaps come across the monochromatic imperial pied imperial pigeon, although the varieties here are usually a little bit more yellow tinged in colour than pure white. Along with this, you're likely to find a good number of other doves and pigeons, along with kukal, cockatoo, parrots, and lots of other species as well. There is a possibility of some evening excursions too. There are two owls that can be found in the region, including the New Britain Boobock and the Golden Masked Owl. And while you're out and about, you may well come across a tree that's lit up by fireflies as well. In Kimby Bay itself, it's a fantastic area to explore under the water as well as above, and around the islands as well as on different parts of the ocean, there are quite a lot of different types of reef. So there'll be a chance to do some snorkeling there with its fantastic colourful coral underneath, showing lots and lots of different varieties as well, along with a lot of different marine life, including some lovely seahorses, as well as sea fans and stars, and lots of fish, including some that might be quite familiar, such as this clown anemone, or perhaps a little bit more unusual, this pink-trailed triggerfish. Excuse me. On the islands themselves, there are quite a few nesting birds where they're away from predators on the land. And these include species such as a Nicobar pigeon, as well as a number of other different imperial pigeon species, fruit doves and kingfisher. There'll be time for a final day of exploration as well, possibility of perhaps some more wildlife encounters. If you haven't had enough birds by that point, then there might be the opportunity to head out and find some lowland bird species, such as the Melanesian scrub fowl, which is often found along the banks of the hot water rivers. You might like to find out a little bit more about the local villages and their way of life there, including their relationship with the betel nut. Some of the other obvious species that you'll see around and about are the large butterflies, such as the birdwing butterflies. But it may also be a preference that you would just want to relax and enjoy the stunning place and the fantastic scenery before you have to finally return to Port Moresby for the journey home. As with many of our tours, it's not just the places that we stay during the tour that we are able to visit. Some people like to extend their tour and stay a little bit longer, or places that we can do as a more tailored itinerary as well. Some people like to spend some additional time in Port Moresby, but other areas that can be considered to add some extra days to your trip are the Sepik River region, which is up on the north coast of Papua New Guinea. Travel in this region is mainly by boat because there are lots of rivers and waterways around there, and it's home to the tribe of the crocodile people. Some of the key birding highlights that you might find in this area include the 12-wired bird of paradise, the large palm cockatoo, and the stunningly beautiful Victoria crowned pigeon. Out to the west is Lake Murray, and the lodge here is surrounded by forest, swampland, grassland and savanna. The swampland here is rumoured to hold its own version of Nessie, some sort of prehistoric creature. However, you're more likely to come across some of the bird life, particularly in this area, which can include water birds such as this very smart black bittern, or perhaps some more bird of paradise species, such as the magnificent rifle bird or the very bright king bird of paradise. Right down in the southwest of the country, not far from the border with Indonesia, is Bensbach Wilderness Lodge. And this is located on a floodplain area, so it's a relatively flat area all round. And at the right time of year, it's a fantastic migration hotspot. And the wetlands there can be filled with large flocks of geese and pelicans, along with different fish hunting raptors taking advantage of the abundance. Mammals are a little bit more obvious in this region, and they might include the agile wallaby or perhaps the introduced rusa deer. There are also some large reptiles that you might come across, including several species of monitor lizard. The lodge and accommodation to try and make the most of its local resources, so it's perhaps not surprising that Bensbach is quite famous for serving local barramundi and venison in the dining room. There are lots and lots of different possibilities and itineraries that can be done in Papua New Guinea, and people have enjoyed staying in lots and lots of different places while they've been there. But you don't need to be a keen birder to enjoy the country and to appreciate all the different aspects of it. If you do have any questions or want to find out more about it, please do feel free to get in touch. But otherwise, I'm going to hand back to Sarah now. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Alison. That was fantastic. Amazing photos there. That Raggiana bird of paradise is just incredible. The King of Saxony one as well. Absolutely outrageous. I was in the Natural History Museum a couple of weeks ago and I saw one on display. And what you don't really appreciate from a photograph is just how scale-like those two feathers protruding from the head are. They don't really look much like feathers at all, do they? Up close, they're more like a snake skin or something.
They're different colour on each side as well, so they've got a different coloration on each side of them as well, so it's just amazing.
Just fantastic. Well, that was brilliant. Thank you for that whistle stop tour, much appreciated. All right, folks, we're going to go to a break now, just 10 minutes, so we'll be back at 8:25. You've got time to nip to the loo, top up your wine or your tea and coffee and your bowl of nibbles, whatever you might be eating, if you are eating, and we'll be back here in 10 minutes time at 8:25. See you shortly.
In South Australia I was born.
Heave away, haul away.
South Australia, round Cape Horn.
We're bound for South Australia.
All the way up, rolling king.
Heave away, haul away.
All the way up, hear me sing.
We're bound for South Australia.
As I went out one morning fair.
Heave away, haul away.
But there I met this Nancy Blair.
We're bound for South Australia.
All the way up, rolling king.
Heave away, haul away. Australia.
I shook her up, I shook her down.
Heave away, haul away.
I shook her round about the town.
We're bound for South Australia.
Haul away, up, rolling king.
Heave away, haul away.
Haul away, up, hear me sing.
We're bound for South Australia.
There was but one thing creased me mind.
Heave away, haul away.
What's the name, Miss Nancy? Behind.
We're bound for South Australia.
All the way up, rolling king.
Heave away, haul away.
All the way up, hear me sing.
We're bound for South Australia.
As we went down around Cape Horn.
Heave away, haul away.
No, wish to God you'd never been born.
We're bound for South Australia.
All the way up, rolling king.
Heave away, haul away. South Australia.
In South Australia I was born.
Heave away, haul away.
South Australia, round Cape Horn.
We're bound for South Australia.
All the way up, rolling king.
Heave away, haul away.
All the way,
you'll hear me sing. We're bound for South Australia.
Right, welcome back, folks. Apologies if that music for the interval startled any of you out of your seats. I was going to give you a heads up that I'd start playing a sea shanty, but hopefully you enjoyed it. Right, now, opening our second half of the evening is Paul Harms, who's going to talk to us about the wildflowers of Western Australia. Over to you, Paul.
Thanks, Sarah. Let me just share my screen. Hello, what am I doing there? That's what I want. And it's that one. Grand. Whoops, gone one too far already. Good evening, everybody. I'm going to have a chat to you about the wildflowers of Western Australia, an area that is very, very rich botanically in that part of the world. It ranks alongside South African area of Southern Africa at the Fynbos, etc., and the Karoo in that part of the world, both of which are extremely interesting, fascinating, and diverse. My personal favourite is just Western Australia, but we will. I'm sure there are those who would agree differently. That wasn't supposed to happen. Sorry, pardon. I'm just looking for that, which is the laser pointer. We begin our trip to this part of the world. It's a 17-day tour, and we fly into Perth from Dubai. Perth is the largest city in that part of the world, one of the most remotest on in the world as well. Excuse me. We spend a couple of days in Perth, staying at the Miss Maud Hotel, a Swedish hotel. We will look at King's Park, which is beautifully put together as an official botanic garden, and then it drifts into natural bush at the same time. So you can spend quite a bit of time looking at the formal areas and then looking at the much more informal areas. We will also look at other sites around Perth on the inland side of the Swan River. On our third day, we will start moving north. Up through to Durian and Eneabba, moving on up towards Geraldton, and eventually the furthest north we get is Kalbarri, number three on my map, where we will spend a couple of nights visiting the Murchison River National Park, a very warm part of the world, a very sandy part of the world, and again, very interesting. We will stop it overnight in Durian on our way up to Kalbarri. When we finish in Kalbarri, we will move south towards Geraldton from Northampton, cut across out through towards Mullowa and to a place called Pindar, which has the famous wreath flowers, where we will spend some time as we work through. And we will then work our way down through the wheat belt, down through the central area through Morawa and on down through Dalwallinu and on through to the Wongan Hills and on down through Northiam and York, moving down towards Narrogin, down at the bottom here, and the Dryandra Woodlands, a very interesting area to spend some time. May also be an opportunity here, if time permits, to do some infrared spotting of small marsupials at night. This area has got no light pollution whatsoever. And consequently, if it's a clear night, the stars are absolutely fantastic. Certainly well worth the being out there and looking to look at. From Wagin, we can move out through to Lake Grace and down through Pingarup. We're basically heading at this point down to Bremer Bay. Bremer Bay is on the edge of the Fitzgerald River National Park, a national park that's approximately the size of Sussex in the UK. It's enormous. Very, very interesting and fascinating. As you're looking south from here, you've got nothing between you and the Antarctic. There are a possibility here of some good seabirds, including both the larger albatross species wandering and, oh, for heaven's sake, I can't remember the other one, the other big one as well. Moving from that area, we will move along the south coast towards Albany, where we will spend time slightly north of Albany, about an hour or so, an hour and a half north in the Stirling Ranges, another famous part of the world in this area. Again, very good botanically, and also there are good reptiles and birds up here as well. Then moving along the south coast through Walpole, we will visit the Carey Forest. The Careys are the biggest of the eucalypts. Some of them can be as much as 250 feet tall, massive, massive trees of the of that particular family. Moving on up through Manjimup to Busselton on the Bunbury. At Bunbury, there are some rather nice mangrove swamps, and they can be quite rich, both from marine life and also bird life, and the plants themselves as well, several species of the mangroves. And then we move on back up to Perth, where we will finish the holiday. As I said, it's about 17 days of travel, and we will be visiting various places along the way. Our mode of transport will be probably something similar to this. This was Coates, our local agents in that part of the world. It's a coach built specifically for travel of groups. And it also takes a trailer on the back, which takes our luggage. It also carries chairs and tables for morning tea and lunch and all those sort of things. So it's very comfortable and a good way to travel when you're quite high up, so you can see fairly well. This is the King's Park from looking across the Swan River, where we spend our first day in Perth, which is the area I mentioned to you of the Botanic Gardens and the bush area. This is a rather splendid example in the middle here of a mottled car or Eucalyptus macrocarpa, the largest flowered member of that family. As we're moving north towards Durian at Cervantes, you have the wonderful Pinnacles Desert with these lovely limestone formations. It looks completely artificial, but I assure you it isn't. Especially as we visit it towards the end of the day, when you get very, very long shadows. It's absolutely fascinating place and rather a sort of eerie place of its own as well. Also at Cervantes, there's Lake Theseus, and Lake Theseus has has stromatolites, this form of very, very early life form, almost bacterial, cyanobacteria, which can produce a form of glue which sticks rock and sand and what have you together and makes these crusty-like formations in the water of the lake. That part of Western Australia is quite well known for these ancient life forms. Ellerdale Pool, as we're moving north, is an area of bush and cliff. These folk here are looking at wedge-tailed eagle and peregrine facing off to one another on a ledge above. This is the Murchison River at Kalbarri, or part of it. It's again quite a lot of water there and a sandy scrub. This was a group from the last time we visited, Naturetrek group. And then the Stirling Ranges is another area I mentioned. We're looking across here towards Bluff Knoll, which is the highest point, and we will spend a good day traveling around and looking at the interesting parts of the world what they have to offer here. As we move back towards past Albany and along towards back towards Perth, we go past the Gloucester tree at Pemberton. This was a eucalyptus tree that was used as a fire outlook post. If you look at the bottom through the word tree, you can see some dark marks on the trunk as you move north. These are the bars sticking out the side, which is the ladder that you have to climb to go up. Rather them than me, I think is the phrase, but it's no longer used as an outlook, but people do still go up it, I understand. Okay, I'm now going to look at some of the more interesting plant groups that we see. I'm not going to be location specific, but one of the main groups of plants that we see in this part of the world are the Banksias, named after Joseph Banks. One of the great founders, discoverers of the botany of Western Australia was a guy called James Drummond. He used to spend weeks out in the bush collecting and then parceling up and sending back to Joseph Banks in the early 1800s. And as such, that would be about a 12-month turnaround. These were named after Banks himself. So this is Banksia. And then there's this one is, oh, pardon me. How do I go back? No. Oh, bother. Okay, I've gone whipped through a couple there that I didn't need to.
You might just be able to use your arrow keys to go back, Paul.
Oh, yes. Thank you very much. Sorry, not played that game before. Thank you, Sarah. Scarlet Banksia, which is in the Fitzgerald River National Park, which is one of the spectacular ones that folk always want to see. And then Hooker's Banksia. And Oakleaf Banksia, which are all very, very, they're all very similar. These are one of the groups of plants in that part of the world that require bushfires to actually encourage the seeds to germinate. And so if you find a burn site, you often find these things just starting to come up quite quickly after the fire has passed through. This is a ground living one called Creeping Banksia that just lives on the ground. I mentioned back at King's Park that we saw mottled car, which is the largest of the eucalyptus flowered trees. This flower is about 3.5 to 4 inches in diameter. It really quite huge and very, 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 very attractive. Bell-fruited melee. The melees are another group of the eucalypts, like the really big tall ones. And we have Eucalyptus parisiana, very, very yellow and very bright. Coral gum. Eucalyptus torquata, again, a very, very attractive species, and one we get to see with this lovely sort of burnished branches. And four-wing melee, which is, again, fairly scarce, but quite a large flower. Again, we see that in the Fitzgerald River National Park. Into the orchids. Now, the orchids in this part of the world are very diverse, and there are lots of them. On the last two occasions I've been, we've seen between 48 and 68 species. This is the cowslip orchid, a huge family called Caladenia. And the Kalbarri spider orchid, again, quite spindly, but quite difficult to see, but once you see them, there are a lot of them. The dragon orchid, again from the Dryandra woodlands. The fabulous Queen of Sheba, we've seen that on a couple of occasions, but it's quite hard to find and doesn't always occur at the same place 3 or 4 years on the trot. So it's infrequent in its occurrence. Another member of the Thelemetra family is this lemon orchid. It's a lemon flowered orchid, again, with these lovely red stigmas. Now, some of the more curious of the orchid group are these articulated orchids. This one's called the flying duck orchid. When an insect lands on the nose or the beak of the duck, it rocks and activates a mechanism which throws the insect onto the back of the plant so that where it's got pollen on its head, it's pushed onto the stigma. But you can see it rather more clearly on this warty hammer orchid. When the insect lands on the left, it is thrown across up onto where that the bit with the little point on the top here is and how it's pollinated. Really quite strange. And they're quite diminutive, again, quite difficult to see, but they are there. Rattlebeaks, again, a plant of the Stirling Ranges, rather attractive looking orchid, about 8 to 10 inches tall. Praesophyllums, the leek orchids, they're always the first to appear after there's been a fire. And the tiny pyrorchis, which is elephant's ears, I guess named after the leaves. This is about 2 inches tall, so a tiny, tiny little plant. Pardon me. Purple enamel orchids, one of the few shiny leaved ones that you get in Western Oz. And the lovely rabbit orchid, one of my favorites. And again, very attractive little fella. He's not very tall, again, about 3 inches. Okay, grevilleas are another group of well-known plants in this part of the world, and this one's called pink pokers. This is in the Murchison River National Park, and quite common, excuse me. The prickly plume grevillea, one of the few that actually hangs rather than is out straight or standing up. So it's one of the dangling plants. One of my favourite ones, the black toothbrush, black toothbrushes. Really quite stunning and very, very striking as well. one plant in the Fitzgerald River National Park that you should never miss is the Royal Hakea. On a dull day, this is just a dark green leaved plant as the central spike is at the base. However, when the sun shines through it, you get this wonderful orange and yellow and appearance to it. Very, very striking, and can be up to 6 feet tall. Quite an impressive plant. Drummond, when he sent a specimen to Banks, suggested that it be named after the Queen, hence the name Royal Hakea and Hakea Victoria. Pineapple bush, one of these tall like trees with all the leaves and foliage at the top, and the fruiting bodies just starting to appear. It's got very wide, quite wide leaves, quite distinct, again, you know, up to 6 or 7 feet tall. As opposed to the grass trees, the king ears, we've got much more narrow leaves, much more robust flowering heads, and not as tall. Quite striking again, and noticeable in the bush from quite a distance. Mangles kangaroo paw, Agonisanthus manglesii. You can see where on the right hand side here where the anthers are sticking out, looking like claws at the end of a paw. Very striking. There are several members of that particular family, and then there's another little orangey yellow one called a cat's paw, so there's quite a few. And interestingly, the colour, the dark green and the red, is actually caused by the hairs on the plant itself. They are actually the colour. The whole thing underneath is sort of a dull green, but the hairs are these bright red and bright green. The styleidiums are known as trigger plants. The stigma in the middle here is on a trigger formation, and when an insect lands on it, it's fired across onto the style. This particular one is one of the bigger ones, and these flowers are about 1.5 inches from top to bottom. It's quite a large beastie. The trigger plants, there are many of them, some of which have yet to be described. At Albany, you get the fabulous Albany pitcher plant, Cephalotus, quite a naturally occurring pitcher plant. It grows on the ground in very, very wet areas. There's one little reserve in Albany where it occurs in small numbers, but a little further along towards Denmark, there's a site along there where there is an awful lot of it, a very, very, very large quantity of it, quite robust. Those little pitchers are about an inch and a quarter tall and about 3/4 of an inch wide, quite striking and quite impressive. The wreath plants out at Pindar that I mentioned when I was giving you the quick run around of where we will visit are very popular. All the local villages, if you go to the local town hall, they have notices up on the door or somebody actually telling you where the best place to go today to see them in flower is, which is very helpful. There are several members of the Leschenaultia family, but this pink and cream one is the well-known wreath flower. Basically, it's got a central stem and all the a root and all the stems sort of flare out from it, and they flower at the tips. So it makes it look like a circle of flowers. We do see reptiles while we're on the trip as well. Two of the common ones here are the bobtail skink on the left with a wonderful blue tongue, and the thorny or mountain devil on the right, which you may see if you're lucky in the Murchison River, where we've seen both. Western grey kangaroo and eastern grey kangaroo occur in the west of Australia, and also southern right whale, regularly seen from the coast at Kalbarri. You can tell it from a long way out because the spout actually splits into two when it comes up. Also at Point Anne in the Fitzgerald River National Park, there is a place where the cows come in with their young into the shallows, into the warm shallows where they suckle their young. And they're often there when we visited in the past, which is quite exciting. I mentioned that we might be able to look at nocturnal marsupials. Two of them here, the bilby, which has got huge ears and a slightly pointed snout, and the little numbat, which is unusual. There's also quokkas and quolls, which are small wallaby type marsupials. But if we get the chance, we go out to look for these under infrared light in the open forest. On to the birds. In King's Park, red wattle birds are very, very common. They are everywhere and they're always looking for food. Long-billed black cockatoos are one of the more unusual ones we get along the way on this trip. Usually on the way in towards Pindar from Geraldton, we quite often see them along that particular coast there. There are a lot of parrots in this part of Australia. Wedge-tailed eagles, I think Roger mentioned those earlier. We do get to occasionally see these, and they are quite majestic when you do. Thank you everybody for listening to that. It was a quick whistle stop through Western Australia, and thanks all for listening, and I will hand you over to Matt now, who is going to talk to you about Queensland.
That's great, Paul. Thank you very much indeed. Just stop sharing your screen.
Just trying to stop sharing. Oh, there I go.
That's all good. Okay, mine works. Lovely, jolly. Well, a very good evening, everyone, and thank you very much for joining. My name's Matt, and I work in the operations team at Naturetrek, and have done now for almost 2 years. So it's been rather torturous 2 years, but it's all starting to look up now. So tonight, I'm actually talking to you from Somerset, where I'm leading a private RSPB group here. So if there are any RSPB members watching, and you do wish to have a private multi-day trip, then please do get in touch. But for now, I am going to talk to you about Queensland. So here we go. So Queensland is the second largest state in Australia, and it's based up there in the northeast, and it's a very large state. And how we get there, we take that very long flight and we land into Brisbane in the southeast corner. But you'll be very pleased to hear that after that very long traveling, there isn't actually too much traveling once you're there. So we go to the very best spots in Queensland, but we also ensure that we have very few miles on the road. So I'm sure you'll all be very pleased to hear that. Okay, so why should we go to Queensland? And so it has one of the wonders of the world, the Great Barrier Reef, has one of the largest populations of koala bear compared to any other state in Australia. And it has over 1,000 vertebrate species, many of which are unique to Queensland. And there's also a wide variety of habitats. It's got lush forests, you've got mountains, and you also got that extensive coastline that runs all the way up to Cairns. So an absolute stunning state for diversity. So we do, this is the main tour I'm going to talk about this evening. It's a 16-day bird watching tour. However, you can also incorporate this into a tailor-made tour as well. So if this is something that does interest you, please contact Georgie and she will be happy to sort that out for you. But for the sake of tonight, I'm just going to concentrate on the main areas on this 16-day itinerary. So there you can see we fly into Brisbane, and then we fly straight up to Cairns. That gives you the opportunity to go to the Great Barrier Reef. Then we head inland slightly and go to Daintree National Park in the Atherton Tablelands before we head back down south to Brisbane and venture into Lamington National Park. Now, I think it's a sin actually to not experience some of the smaller parks which are found around the city of Brisbane. So you may fancy, if you do fancy going on this tour, just to spend a couple of days beforehand to get used to the birds. And there are a number of these parks situated on the outskirts of Brisbane. And here you can see a wide number of species, easily 50, 60, 70 species in a day. That's entirely not a problem. So you've got the water there, you've got the trees, and you also have gardens as well. And this produces a wide variety of birds, and you can see out in the water there two Australian pelicans. So other birds that can be found around these parks, blue-winged kookaburras, they're very common, as are the laughing kookaburras. Both birds can be seen on roadside poles as you're driving to and fro these parks, very common, but very striking as well. And the parks also hold massive numbers of corellas. It's a type of parrot. So as I'm sure you can imagine, they do enough make a racket when they come into the trees. And when I was there at this one park, there was a couple having a picnic underneath one of the trees, and they soon moved because I don't think they could hear each other talking. So large numbers of parrots here. Superb fairy wren. Now the fairy wrens are typically found in Australasia, nowhere else in the world, and they're all as striking as one another. And this is very aptly named the superb fairy wren. And these can just be seen bouncing around on people's lawns. It's all rather a bit strange compared here to the UK, but this is a typical garden bird out in Australia. Now, Australian pelicans, they do come into the fresh water, but they are mainly coastal. So if you head to the coast, you'll bound to see more of these, but they are also found very commonly around freshwater bodies around the city. Now, magpie lark, this is a strange chap. It's very similar, I guess, to our magpie, that they're found in parks, gardens, open lands, and roughly the same plumage as well, but it's a lark. So it's very aptly named the magpie lark. And again, these are very common around the suburbs. So an absolute wonderful species to see. And Australian darter, so very much like our cormorant, I guess, but darters are found in the Southern Hemisphere, South America, Africa, Asia, and also here in Australasia. And this is aptly named the Australian darter. Now, also around the suburbs, it gives you a chance to find our nocturnal species. So our guides, they know where these roost sites are. And these are tawny frogmouths. It's one of the largest frogmouths in the world. And believe it or not, these three are actually youngsters. So the adult is around somewhere, but it just gives you an indication of how large these birds actually are. And look at those eyes. You can tell they're nocturnal. Absolutely stunning birds. And another nocturnal specialist that can be found again in these suburbs is the powerful owl, very well named due to its more raptor shape or more raptor appearance. And again, these can be found with our guides. They know where these sites are and they will take you to go and see these nocturnal specialists. So powerful owl, absolute stunner. So our time in Brisbane is short-lived, or very short-lived, depending on if you want to spend a couple of days there before we head up to Cairns. Now, I'm only going to briefly touch on the Great Barrier Reef because I want to concentrate on the land side of things. But of course, I'm on this tour or on a tailor-made tour, you can spend all the time you wish in the Great Barrier Reef. And so here it is. Obviously, there are small pockets, large pockets that still look like this. Of course, there is the coral bleaching going on, but you can find pockets which are absolutely pristine coral. And here we are, just a nice underwater shot there. And sadly, that's all I'm going to mention on the Great Barrier Reef. Do apologise if you were looking for the underwater part for tonight. But I'm going to concentrate on the land. And our lodge up in the Tablelands is Kingfisher Park Lodge. And it's very well named, mainly because there's many species of kingfishers there. So this is the little kingfisher, that wonderful cobalt blue upper parts and contrasted with the white underparts there. An absolutely wonderful bird. And it is indeed very small. Now this is the buff-breasted paradise kingfisher. Now paradise kingfishers are slightly different from the normal kingfishers. There's only one found in Australia, and that is this chap, the buff-breast. All the others are found on the island of New Guinea or in eastern Indonesia. So this is one of eight species in the world. And you can tell it's a paradise kingfisher because it has that amazing long tail. And Kingfisher Park Lodge is by far the best spot to see this cryptic species. And as you can see, a bit of flash photography, a bit of eye shine there. So these birds normally spend their time in the dark areas rather than coming out into the open. So a nice challenge for the photographers. Now, another challenge for the photographers is the noisy pitter. Now, pitters are extraordinary birds. They're extremely skulky and they're very thrush-like in that they hop about and search for earthworms or other insects underneath the leaf litter. But they're very brightly colored. Every pitter in Africa, Asia, or Australasia is just very striking, and you'll be awestruck when you see one. So this is noisy pitter, and they are indeed very noisy. Now we do also get birds of paradise in Queensland. This is one of three species that can actually be found in Queensland. The others are a trumpet manukode and the paradise rifle bird. So this is the Victoria's rifle bird. All very similar to rifle birds. They all do their head shuffling, as I'm sure you've seen in the Attenborough documentaries. And this is a male, and it gives off an amazing call that penetrates through the forest. I'm not going to try to personate it, but trust me, it is an evocative sound and one you must hear. It's absolutely wonderful. So yes, we do get birds of paradise in Australia, and they are very much sought after and well worth going to see. Again, these can be seen up in at Kingfisher Park Lodge. So this is the female. Again, not too bad, quite striking, but yeah, not as striking as the old male. Now, we also spend a bit of time trying to find the Australian bustard. So our time up in Kingfisher Park Lodge is spent in forest, wetlands, but also in dry open plains as well. And this is where we have a chance of seeing the Australian bustard. And again, this is the only species within the family that is found in Australasia. All the others are found in Asia and Africa and Europe, of course. Okay, so that is pretty much our time in the north. I'm so sorry that's short-lived, but I wish to take you down now to Lamington National Park. So from Cairns, we will fly directly back down to Brisbane, and it's roughly a two-hour drive into Lamington National Park. And this is one of my favourite national parks, not only in Australia, but in the entire world, mainly because there are many different levels. So you start at sea level, and then you gradually rise to where the accommodation is in amongst the trees at the higher altitude. But please don't worry, there's no altitude sickness, it's not that high, but it's high enough to get a different range of species. So this is the accommodation within the park, and for those eagle-eyed viewers amongst you this evening, I'm sure you've spotted the hot tubs on each balcony. Yes, those are indeed hot tubs, and I'm sure they'll be very enticing for many of you. So after a long slog through the forest during the day, there's nothing better than coming back to the hot tub. And these apartments, they're just so grand. It's hard to explain, but you will certainly be impressed. And this is a view from above, bird's eye view of the accommodation. So as you can see, it's well within all the forest. So the wildlife is right on your doorstep. And I strongly suggest 3, 4, or 5 days here to really get the most out of it, because there are many trails that go through the forest. You know, this is one of the largest national parks. So as I'm sure you can imagine, the forest trails just go on and on and on. So definitely worth spending a fair bit of time here. So along the way to Lamington and at the sea level part I just mentioned, you'll come across a few mammals. So this is a red-necked wallaby, and these will be easily seen on the roadside, no effort needed whatsoever. And there they are, just bouncing around happily as anything, feasting on leaves or grass. Now, this is also a very good area to see koala bear. They're not easy. However, you can get lucky as long as you put some time into finding them. That's the key there. And this is the general view that you would get of the koala, not the standing out in the open. It's more lots of leaf litter in the way, and you're waiting for the movement in the treetops. But of course, seeing a koala bear is a highlight of any visit to Australia. And so is the duck-billed platypus. Now, Lamington is actually quite a good area, again, at sea level, not high up, but there is an almost stakeout for this species in the lower elevation. So if you do go, yeah, just get your guide to take you there. And yeah, I'm sure he'd be more than happy to show you, but you've got to get there early. You've no laying in on that one. Okay, now around the grounds is an excellent area for the wildlife. So at Lamington, many species are habituated and they come in and they don't get close to the humans. Yeah, they still know we're here and a potential threat, I guess. But you get amazing views of many species. So this is red-necked pademelon. So this is the smallest member of the kangaroo family. And it's a delightful little chap, and they can often be seen just in the open grounds, a few minutes walk away from your accommodation. Now, Lamington is easily the best spot in Australia to see the Albert's lyrebird. Not the same as the superb lyrebird, but it does still have its own cacophony of noises that it gives out, that the male gives out in the breeding season. But these are normally very skulking species, not often seen out in the open, whereas at Lamington, there they are normally just wandering out in the lawn along the forest edge, and are not too difficult. So again, you know, this is a sought after bird in Eastern Australia. And yet at Lamington, there they are. Now the log runner, this is a cool little bird, very similar to, let's say, turnstone here in the UK. So you see turnstones run along the beach and they rolled in the rocks over to see what's underneath. And this is exactly what the log runner does. And it also uses its legs to shuffle all the undergrowth about just to find those insects. So it's a delightful little bird. And one, again, that's quite easily seen close to the headquarters at Lamington. Now, this may not be everyone's cup of tea, but for those that it maybe their cup of tea, you can have a feeding session with the parrot. So these are wild birds, all completely wild, but of course they're habituated, so they come down and feed on your hands if you wish. So something that you may want to partake in while you're there. So this is a crimson rosetta, absolutely stunning bird, and rainbow lorikeets, which are found throughout Australia, a very common bird, but striking nonetheless. Eastern whipbird, awesome bird, amazing call. Again, I'm not going to try and do it, but another bird that's very easy to see here. Eastern yellow robin, they hang about by the floodlights or the path lights. So even at night, you can go about and see this delightful little bird. And these are the views. So as I said earlier, there are many forest trails that go through the forest. And of course, these do finally open up to allow these amazing views across the state. I've got to say, Lamington is actually on the edge of the border between Queensland and New South Wales. So you can see far into New South Wales, if that's what you're after. Canopy walkway, if you wish, to get up into those feeding flocks up in the canopy. Green catbirds could be a possibility up there. And of course, the park is renowned for its waterfalls as well. Absolutely stunning landscapes. Oh, a bastion thrush. Yep, they're also quite common. A type of zoophora thrush. So they're very cryptic, very elusive, shy. But apparently not a Lamington. They do feed pretty much in front of you. They think they're hiding, but they're actually not. And regent bowerbirds. So there are two stunning bowerbirds that can be found in the park. This is probably my favourite, the regent bowerbird. Absolutely beautiful contrast between the yellow and black, but just as pretty as the satin bowerbird, which in good light gives off this beautiful bright blue plumage, very similar to a male whistling thrush. Absolutely incredible bird, and if you're lucky, you may also get to see the bowers on your forest walks. Now at night, the birding doesn't stop, so you can have all day in the forest, have your time in the hot tub, hop out, and then go owling or owlet nightjarring. So in Lamington, it's excellent for owls, especially around the accommodation. You'll normally see the most wildlife is around the accommodation block or around the main headquarters. And this is one such Australian owlet nightjar. So this is pretty much what it says on the tin. It looks like an owl. It's kind of a nightjar, so it's an owlet nightjar, but look at those eyes. You can tell it's a nocturnal species, an absolutely incredible bird, really, really class bird. And last but not least, up in the treetops at night, you'll be able to spotlight these common brush-tailed possums. These are very common, and you often hear them rustling around above you. A delightful species and one that's very common around the park. Well, folks, I think that's my time up. So sadly, I was quite enjoying that. But thank you very much for listening. If you have any questions about Queensland at all, please come to me or please email Georgie. We will both be happy to help you out on your travel plans. But for now, I think I will call it a day and hand you back to Sarah. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Matt. Some fantastic photos there. And right, folks, we're now going to take some questions. We'll open up the floor, as it were, for questions this evening. So we have our first question here from Maya. And Maya's asking, do you have any tours covering Australia's Northern Territory? Georgie, are you able to answer this one?
Absolutely, yeah. So we have had tours to the Northern Territory in the past, and it's certainly something that we are hoping to do again. Probably at this stage, we'd be looking at 2024, I would have thought, by the time that we do get group tours out to the Northern Territory. But we could certainly organise tailor-made extensions or to join other sort of small group tours. So yeah, it's certainly possible. And get in touch if that's something you'd like to do.
Fantastic. Thank you, Georgie. Alison, I have a question from Philip Hayward. Is Papua New Guinea open for tourists?
Not at this present time. I believe it's still primarily essential travel to Papua New Guinea only. like with many countries, we're not absolutely sure when that's going to change, but we're hoping it will be at some point early next year.
Okay, so like with a couple of countries at the moment, just have to keep our fingers crossed. Now, Roger, I've got a question for you, and it's something that a few people have been mentioning here on the chat. Just before the pandemic, our media channels here in the UK were full of horrendous images of wildfires in Australia and heartbreaking stories of destroyed habitat and injured wildlife. And then the pandemic struck, and it's not featured on our news since. So can you just give us an update? Can you firstly remind people where in Australia the wildfires were? And let us know how badly damaged the forests were and how serious this has been for the wildlife.
Yeah, it's a very good question. It's something that's very dear to my heart, and I have I try and answer for it. First of all, I just want you to understand that a lot of the international media showed all of Australia on fire, which was a little bit of an exaggeration for the biggest island continent in the world. It would have been impossible. The second thing to understand is that in areas where there were bushfires, not all the bush got burnt. For instance, in our East Gippsland area, a very large area of East Gippsland was burnt, but we still managed to run tours there in areas of forest that weren't burnt. So it's important to understand that it wasn't cataclysmic in the sense of the whole country being burned. But I would also like to say to you that this is an indication of climate change. It does have a big impact on the way that tourism is going to operate in the future. But there are a lot of Australians who are working very, very hard to try and overcome this problem by the work we're doing to do with ameliorating climate change. I know that sounds a bit weird to you at the moment, having heard what Australia's been talking about at COP26, but I'm not going to hide the fact that a lot of Australia was burnt. There's no doubt about that. But as Matt has shown you, and as Paul has shown you, and I have shown you, there are large areas of Australia which are still available to look at and to view, and the wildlife is coping with climate change. I don't want people to think that Australia has just been burnt to the ground. The other thing to remember too is that the Australian bush does recover from bushfire. We have lost a lot of our wildlife, Sarah, but we are starting to see it recovering slowly. So come and have a look at it. Help us resolve the problem with the Koala Clancy Foundation. Help us grow more trees. Help us get things back to the way they were. I don't know whether I've answered your question, but at least it's given you an idea of where we stand at the present time. Now, as you can see, Matt nodding his head. You know what I mean, Matt. It's not an easy one. But if we ignore it, if we ignore this as tour operators and pretend that climate change isn't affecting us, we are playing games. The future is going to be about how we in the tourism industry and as travellers in the tourism industry help to overcome this problem. I'll stop there, Sarah. I could talk about this for hours.
I'm sure you could, Roger, but no, wise words there. I quite agree. Thank you for phrasing that so concisely, when I know that that is a very, very big question that we could have a good debate about for quite some time. Georgie, a question for you. Is it possible to extend any of the tours that have been talked about tonight with a tailor-made trip?
Absolutely. We've had a couple of questions, actually. The Northern Territory, we could certainly organise something there, or somebody's just asked about the Flinders Ranges instead as well. But actually, we've organised our holidays to Australia and New Zealand, actually, next year, so that they can be taken back to back, as we do appreciate it's a very long way to travel. People are concerned about their carbon footprint and don't necessarily want to be doing that journey several times. So we have now made it possible to do one very long trip to encompass all of Australia at once. We also know that it's lots and lots of people want to go out and visit Australia to see family and incorporate time with family within that, and then arrange some wildlife extensions around that as well. So I would say Australia is probably one of the places where we do most tailor-made extensions for people. It's certainly possible. We'll work with Roger and his team and lots of other excellent guides, local guides out there. So yeah, certainly do get in touch if you'd like to organise something.
Thanks, Georgie. And Paul, a couple of questions for you. What's the best time of year for the flora in Western Australia? And can all of the flowers that we've seen in your presentation be seen on the trip?
Yes, they can. We go in September, which is early spring in that part of Australia. And that is by far the best time to go. It's warm during the day, but it can be still quite frosty at night, especially in the Dryandra Forest. Quite often I remember the first time I went there, I got back to my room at about 11 o'clock at night and the electric blanket was on and I was very pleased for it. It was very chilly. However, that time of the year, you'll see all of the plants that you saw in that presentation are seen in that 16, 17 days at that time of the year.
Thanks, Paul. Right, folks, do we have any more questions for the panel? Please do type them now or forever hold your peace. I don't think we've got any more coming in, and all of the ones that have been typed to us, I see, have been answered. I'll just have a quick check of the chat, giving anyone an opportunity to frantically type something if they want to. But no, I think that's all of our questions for this evening. Is there any other points that any of the panelists would like to raise? Roger, fire away.
There was a question about the Northern Territory. Georgie, I won't go on about this, but I just wanted to say to you that we do run one, I think you know that we run a trip to the Northern Territory to the top end, just to the top end. It's a 7-day trip. If anybody is interested in talking to you about that, I'm sure we could arrange something we do one in September, late August, September. So all the best with that one.
Be in touch.
Great, thanks Roger, and lovely to see your comments, folks. Thank you so much for giving us the nice feedback, and thanking us for another illuminating evening. Thank you, Carol, really kind feedback, and we really do appreciate knowing that you're enjoying these presentations, folks. It makes it all the worthwhile doing all of the background work, and knowing that they're appreciated is really great. And a big thank you to Georgie, Alison, Matt, Paul and Roger for presenting to us tonight. And thank you all so much for joining us from home as well. Our roadshow continues next week, where we'll be taking you to Canada and Alaska. That's on Wednesday, the 8th of December. So keep an eye out for your emails, because we're also about to launch a whole new suite of presentation evenings for the new year, which will run weekly up until the end of March. Don't forget, you can also join us tomorrow at 12 noon, where we've got our next virtual tour, which we broadcast live from the cloud forests of Sevegre Mountain in Costa Rica. And so you can join our guides, Eric and Paco, in search of some fantastic wildlife. There'll be a great variety of tropical bird life for you to see, I'm sure. And you can sign up for that on our website. My colleague Barney will be hosting it. And we hope you can join us. So until the next time, folks, take care. And we'll see you again next week.
Thank you. Bye.
Night.
Thanks, everyone.